Now, you're coming just about to the end of your study of the book of Revelation. It's been a lengthy one. I hope it's been beneficial to you. I don't know how many messages we've gotten out of it, but quite a few, to say the least. And hopefully you've gotten some understanding that you didn't have before in reference to the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation is a real important book for you to rightly divide. If you don't rightly divide the book of Revelation, you can get yourself into a whole lot of trouble. The next thing you know, you can wind up where we're going to be here today here for just a few minutes. You can wind up with yourself over here in the at the Great White Throne Judgment. And again, you see the principle of making sure that you get your judgments in the right place. If you don't, if you just read the Bible like a general, like some people take it as a storybook, they just read it all the way through from Genesis to Revelation, say, well, it's just one continual story. Well, you're going to wind up in some serious trouble when it comes to your biblical doctrine, because everything in the world is different in the Old Testament as compared to the New Testament. If you don't rightly divide and put the church in, and the fundamental things that I've taught you here, who's talking? Is it God? Is it the devil? Or is it a person? It's important to know who's talking. It's important to know who he's talking to. Is he addressing the nation of Israel? Is he addressing the Gentile? Or is he addressing the church? If he's not addressing the church, then you've got to make sure that you take what he's saying and line it up with the Pauline epistles. And when you line it up with the Pauline epistles, if it doesn't contradict the Pauline epistles, then you can take what he's saying. That's why we preach out of the Old Testament. The Bible says in the Old Testament is written for our admonition and for our learning. There's a lot of great principles and a lot of things you can learn in the Old Testament by learning from their mistakes as well as their successes. But you always want to take those things and line it up with the Pauline epistles to make sure that it is doctrine for you for this age. Doctrine is absolute truth. It's unchanging truth. You get into the book of Matthew, Acts, and Hebrews, you're headed for trouble if you don't rightly divide those books. You say, why? Almost every false religion and every false cult, and if you ever want to get a good class on cults, get the Bible school class that Brother Brad did on cults. It's like Brother Brad. He covers every detail and every nook and every cranny of all the cults that are out there, and it's a good class for you to get a hold of. It requires some study. I mean, you've got to work at it a little bit. But at any rate, Matthew, Acts, and Hebrews, those are three books that are called transitional books. If you try to get your doctrine out of Matthew, you got somebody over here trying to either cut his foot off or pop his eye out of his head rather than go into hell and that kind of a thing. And you're thinking, well, good night alive, man. I just will go blind here because I'm looking at a woman lusting after her, or I'm walking places I shouldn't go, or I'm stealing stuff I shouldn't steal, so it's better for me to cut it off and that kind of a thing. Or then you turn it into something figurative. That's literal for somebody. It's just not for you. Some of you look shocked. That's literal in the millennial kingdom. Matthew 5, 6, and 7, that's the constitution, or what you would say the law for the millennial kingdom. What he says there is that because it's all works in the millennium, it's better for you not to have stolen something, better for you to cut your hands off to keep you from stealing something and go around without any hands than for you to get cast into hell for stealing something. You remember the passage in the Bible where he says, don't fear him that can cast a body, don't fear of him that can kill the body, but fear him that can cast body and soul into hell? Well, you don't find anywhere in your Bible where the body goes into hell except in the millennium. In the millennial kingdom, hell is literally here. It's in the valley of Gehenna down there at the bottom of Jerusalem, and that place is an open cesspool like an open sore, and you look down in that place right there, and people can literally be cast right out of the city of Jerusalem and right into the lake of fire, of hell, right there. That's where Jehovah's Witnesses get the fire, hell being on earth. Hell will be on earth, but not now. And it won't be the entire earth. It'll be a particular place. Matthew's a transitional book. You're going from the Old Testament to the New Testament. You're going from the prophets, and you're going from the law and all that kind of stuff. You're moving into the time when Jesus Christ comes. That's not a good place to get your doctrine from. It is strongly Jewish. And 99% of the book of Matthew is written prior to Calvary and him dying on the cross. Matthew 27 and 28 are the last two chapters in that book, and their crucifixion in Matthew 27 and Matthew 28, the instructions he gives to his apostles, and the church is yet to be born. Now, if you get your book, if you get your doctrine out of the book of Matthew, I didn't say you don't read the book of Matthew, and there's not things for you to learn in the book of Matthew, but if you get your doctrine out of the book of Matthew, you're getting your doctrine before the church has ever even existed. Ladies and gentlemen, the church hasn't always existed. Everybody from Adam to whoever the Z will be on the very end of the thing, whatever the last guy's name is in a millennium, that is not in the body of Christ. If you don't make the delineation of that right there, you're going to have a hard time with your Bible. You say, well, I just want to believe the whole Bible. Well, stop being so lazy. I don't mean to be crude with you, but stop being so lazy and study to show yourself approved unto God. If you start trying to take promises out of those books right there, for instance, let's go to the book of Acts. Well, in the book of Acts, everything's in a constant uproar. In Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit's given. In Acts chapter number 4 and 5 and 6, you have stuff going on there that is all Jewish. You got nothing going on with the church there at all. You don't have a Gentile saved until Acts chapter number 8. And then the Ethiopian eunuch there in Acts 8, and then the Cornelius in Acts chapter 10. Paul's called out in Acts chapter 9, but he doesn't start preaching the thing till Acts 15. If you don't rightly divide your Bible, do you know what you got? You've got a person that gets up and calls. They start what's called the Church of Christ. Now, I know for some of you this is a rehash, but this is important for you to get a hold of. I get wore out with people saying, well, the Bible's just so difficult. Not if you put it in the proper place. You know, I don't have to know how to fire a nuclear weapon or how to drive an airplane or something. They got books on that kind of stuff. I need books that help me to, you know, fix the plumbing at the house. So those books, they're there for somebody, but they're not there for me. If I'm working on airplanes, I need to know how to work on an airplane. But I don't work on airplanes. So what I do is I got to have books that apply to me. Do you see what I'm saying? All right, the book of Acts, until the Apostle Paul comes along there and he gets called out. And then by Acts 15, him and Peter sit down and have a conversation, and the whole thing switches over to the Gentile, and now it becomes regularly preached. But if you don't do that, you start the Church of Christ, and you say, the Bible says, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, and you shall receive the Holy Ghost. Well, that's what he says for salvation, doesn't he? That's in Acts 2, isn't it? You've got to be baptized to be saved. But then Paul comes around in 1 Corinthians 3 and says, I came not to baptize. Well, wait a minute, but he said you got to baptize. Yeah, our baptism is not for salvation, and it is certainly not for the Holy Ghost. We baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We don't baptize in the name of Jesus Christ, Acts 2:38. What I'm trying to tell you is, if you get your doctrine out of Matthew, Acts, or Hebrews is a good one. In Hebrews chapter number 6, you've got stuff going on there. Hebrews, by the way, it's a little bit of a complicated book because some of it's written before Paul's conversion and some of it's written after Paul's conversion. But the whole thing with it is that the Lord uses the book of Hebrews to write to Jews in the tribulation. So if you go to Hebrews chapter number 6 and you read a passage in there that says it's impossible to renew them again under repentance of those who have tasted the good word of God and so on and so forth, but they've fallen and this and that and the other, well, you just lost your cotton picking salvation. But Ephesians chapter 4 says, I'm sealed to the day of redemption. Well, which one is it? Well, I'm confused. The Bible contradicts itself. No, it doesn't. It doesn't contradict itself at all. The Bible's in perfect line, but you're transferring, you're moving, you're transitioning, going from the church age into the tribulation. There's Hebrews. Acts, you're going from the time of Jesus Christ into the Acts of the Apostles and into the church age. Matthew, you're coming out of the Old Testament and moving into the New Testament. Do you see what I'm saying? That's transitional. Well, that's like you trying to build a house on a foundation that's constantly moving like that. You'd say, well, preacher, nobody'd want to do anything like that. Well, why would you put your doctrine there? You base your doctrine on books that are solid, they're steadfast, they're grounded, they're rooted. You don't have to worry about the foundation shifting around and moving around. And what that does is it keeps you from when you get in here to the book of Revelation, and then we're going to look at this here in just a few minutes, but when you start reading stuff about having your part taken out of the book of life or being removed about the book of life and things like that, you don't know, you realize right off the bat, well, that ain't for me. Because I'm in the body of Christ. I'm bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. Is that what he says? Yes, sir. Well, you don't make a Jesus Christ Frankenstein, that every time you sin, you fall out of the body of Christ. But there's nobody in the body of Christ until the church age. Amen. Nobody is in the body of Christ until the church age. Amen. You're the only one that is part of him. Amen. Everybody else is on the outside. you get the kingdom of God, they get the kingdom of heaven. What's the difference in the two? Well, first of all, they're not spelled the same. Second of all, one of them is a literal, physical, earthly kingdom down here on the face of the earth that'll last forever after the new heaven and new earth is created, and then it goes on out into eternity. Larkin will try to take that thing and do 33 times 1,000 and make it 33,000, and then it stops. The Bible says that their kingdom goes on forever. I don't think it stops. Now, he's a lot smarter fellow than I am, but the bottom line is the Jews inherit the earth, and the Gentile inherits the outer space, and you get the New Jerusalem. I showed you that written. He divides it all the way out in the book of Revelation. He talks about the new heaven, and he talks about the new earth. There's your Jew, and there's your Gentile. And then he talks about the new Jerusalem. There's the bride of Christ. That's three divisions. If you don't make the proper division, then what you try to do is to make the kingdom down here on earth, and you're trying to bring the kingdom in and trying to bring heaven down here on earth, and we're going to wait, and then you become post-millennial, or you become amillennial. You don't even believe in a millennium, or you believe that the Lord's just done as much as he's going to do, and that after you get it all fixed up and make it nice and pretty, then the Lord's going to come down here and bless you and say, well done, boy, you've done a great job. You don't get the earthly thing. You'll rule and reign over it in the millennial kingdom, but then you get the New Jerusalem. You rule and reign over that thing. That city we talked about here on Wednesday night, that city is looks like a 12 to 1,500 miles square, four sides, and then goes up and goes up and goes on. And you can't even imagine the size of that thing. And there's mansions all across there and places there, and you're going to be up there with him in the New Jerusalem. But you've got stuff to do. You'll be bringing people up in there for them to worship and bringing people up there to bring them in the gate so they can partake of the food there, which is the tree of life. And there are 12 manner of fruits for the 12 months of the year, for the 12 apostles at the gates and the 12 gates and all that other kind of stuff. You'll be bringing them up there to do that stuff. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you don't rightly divide your Bible, you reading the book of Revelation, you'll go all the way through the book of Revelation and think that's applicable to you right now. Or you'll have to spiritualize it. Well, it's literal. You get in trouble spiritualizing it. It's a literal book. You say, when are those things going to happen? After I'm out of here. You say, well, where do you get that? I get that Revelation chapter number 4, that we're caught out. And the church winds up getting mentioned again in Revelation 22. But ladies and gentlemen, you start losing that, the chronological order. When you get to Revelation 22, things begin to change. And if you don't rightly divide your Bible, because what he does in Revelation 22 is he starts actually going verse by verse, and one verse will apply to tribulation, another verse will apply to the millennium, another verse will apply to the advent, another verse will apply to the church, and then he'll go back to the tribulation. If you don't make the proper divisions, you'll go crazy. The simple thing is that, well, if it doesn't line up with Pauline doctrine, I'll study it until I figure out where it fits, but I don't have to worry about it. Everything doesn't necessarily have to fit the neat little nook and cranny. Revelation 22. The reason I'm sort of keyed up about that stuff is I had a pretty spirited conversation with a fellow this week, and everything he kept, every verse he kept bringing up was something that he didn't bring up one verse that applied to the church. He was so convinced that after you're saved, if you don't live it, you're going to go to hell. And he'd argue with that wall until he blistered the wall, I guess. But he was so convinced, and I said, well, I guess by that standard, then you're going to hell. And he goes, yeah, I guess I am. I said, well, if you really believe that, I think you'd want to change, wouldn't you? And he goes, there ain't no sense in trying. And I said, exactly, because you can't live it. And he goes, well, that's why I don't bother to try anymore. Are you afraid of hell? So now step two. Well, I don't really believe hell's a literal burning place. Okay, well, let's look at the Bible. Okay, you believe the Bible? Yeah, I believe the Bible. Okay, Mark chapter number 9. The fire is not quenched where the worm dieth not. Where the worm dieth not, the fire is not quenched. Jesus said, you got a red letter Bible? That's Jesus saying that. Revelation 14, the smoke of their torment goeth forever and forever. Hell hath enlarged herself in the Old Testament. Here is a rich man in hell, and Lazarus in Abraham's bosom over here across the thing. And being in torments, for I am tormented in this. F-L-A-M-E. And he goes, well, I know what that says, but I believe it means. And I said, well, I guess you have to air condition hell because you're planning on moving in. He said, well, I believe I got saved a long time ago, but I lost it. And I said, well, you're going to be in for a rude awakening. He said, why is that? I said, you're going to be so shocked, because if you really did get saved, if you really meant business, he goes, well, I really did it. I meant it. I really did mean it. And I said, okay, I'm not doubting you. I'm saying, but if so, when you kick the bucket, you're going to wind up in heaven. You're going to say, well, hell's not such a bad place after all. He said, what do you mean? I said, if you're saved, even if your doctrine's whacked out, the Lord is good to His word. I said, you know what you think? You think you're self-righteous enough that you can keep your salvation. I said, you're a fool to believe that. He said, well, what about you? And I said, I'm fool enough to believe, I'm smart enough, I said, to believe that I can't keep it, that He keeps it for me. It's His salvation. It's not mine. And he goes, I said, you believe the Bible? He said, I believe the Bible. I must ask him that 10 times. And I said, okay, it's a gift of God. Is it a gift or not? And he said, well, yeah. And I said, okay, but if I have to try to do something to keep it after I get it, was it a gift in the first place? You can see him, he's trying to figure his wiggle. Well, but the Bible, you know, now he's going to quote a verse completely out of context. And he throws the whole thing back on it. I said, you're not a Jew. Well, I could be a spiritual Jew. I said, no, you said you ain't even saved, so you ain't spiritual nothing. I said, Bible, you're dead in trespasses and sin, so you ain't nothing. So why are you applying passages? So I just, why are you applying passages that go over the Jew? You're not a Jew. You're not a Jew. You're not nothing. You're a worm. You're going to hell. You're going to burn. You're convinced of it. Okay, fine. Help yourself. I'm, you know, sorry that if you feel that way. But I said, you know what the Bible teaches you? The Bible teaches you that your salvation is sealed to the day of redemption. I showed him the verse. He goes, well, what does that word sealed mean? And then I told a young lady, I said, it's like a can of beans my wife puts up. She puts them in a jar. She puts the lid on that thing, puts it in that boiling pot of stuff, you know, and then it boils, and then she sets that little lid down there, and that thing, it sucks down on there like that. And I said, no matter what happens, that jar gets filthy, that jar gets dirty, that jar gets nasty. You set that jar up on the cabinet. We got stuff sitting in there. I guess we've got enough food for the millennium, but we got stuff sitting up there, you know. It gets dust, it gets dirt, it gets knocked around and banged around and stuff like that. And I said, but the beans are not dirty. And I said, you know, when they get opened, when the owner gets ready to open it. And I said, when you were sealed, I said, that's what happened to you. If you got saved, you're sealed, and you stay sealed until the owner gets ready to open you. That's at death or the rapture.
Yes, sir.
You're sealed to the day of redemption. That's the day the Lord comes and gets your soul and leaves your miserable body behind. He said, well, I've never heard anybody say that before. I said, well, come to church. You hear it pretty regular.
Amen.
He said, well, you know, I you know, go to church, but you know the church is full of hypocrites. I said, you're right, it is. Plenty of room for one more. Come join us. I said, my church is full of hypocrites. Biggest one in the pulpit.
Amen. Amen.
Really? Yeah, really. I said, none of us believe we can live it. I said, your whole problem is, as I said, righteousness without love, bless you, is self-righteousness. You got to learn to love people that are unlovable. That righteousness should be to the point that you're righteous but gracious, not righteous and pharisaical. Jesus Christ, the most righteous individual ever walked the face of this earth. Surely nobody would disagree with that. You ever look at who he hung out with? You ever look at who he loved? Go take a good long look in the mirror. I'm not deluded about it at all. I know what he did when he loved me. I'm sometimes maybe a little bit too rough about it, but I look in the mirror and I look at what I think. Because you know what I know? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he.
Amen.
You know what I know? I look in that mirror. I'm not talking about a man has the character to overcome. Are you hearing me? I'm not talking about a man that knows how to play act and do the things that are right. I'm talking about the Bible says, you want to know what you really are? Turn off all the lights and take a good long look and gander in the mirror. That's who you really are. If you didn't think there was judgment, you weren't going to get caught. That's who you are. And the Lord said, yeah, that's who you are. That's what I know you to be. But you're washed in the blood. You look pretty good to me now. There's not a single one of us can get up there and stack up. All the Lord has to do is open up the cesspool of our mind and say, now what were you saying about how great you were? And all the great works you did and all the great stuff you did and all that other kind of stuff, you're just able to overcome the flesh by walking in the Spirit. But do you want them to see what you really are? No, Lord, put it under the blood. Put it under the blood. Put it under the blood. Right?
Amen.
Revelation 22. That's an important thing for you to grab a hold of. Don't be afraid of making proper divisions. I'll show you. Every one of you is a dispensationalist. I'm going to show you you're a dispensationalist. You ready?
Amen.
Where's your sacrifice today? You don't have a sacrifice? Well, you're going to hell. In the Old Testament, you don't come to worship. You don't come into church. You don't come to service unless you bring a sacrifice. Where's your sacrifice? All right, I'll show you a dispensationalist. You ready? You ready? Anybody in here that has not eaten shrimp or lobster? You're a dispensationalist. You say, why? You ever eat, anybody in here not eat pork? Bacon? Ribs? Ever? Ever? No, you offended one point, you offended all. I can't eat it now, but I have a friend of mine who gives me enough deer meat to choke a horse, man, but I can't have the straight stuff because something in it makes me sick. But you ever eat pork? Well, buddy, if you're not a pork abstaining Jew, you go to hell. You say, well, what does that mean? You're a dispensationalist. You believe, whether you think it or not, what he tells you in 1 Timothy chapter 4, every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused if it be received with prayer and thanksgiving. You ever eat catfish? Slick skin fish? You can't eat slick skin fish. Not in the Old Testament. It's got to have fins and scales. So, well, catfish has got fins. He ain't got no scales. They're slimy. And they eat off the bottom. And their meat's sometimes yellow. Like it's got hepatitis or something. You ever eat organ meat? You know, liver, heart, squirrel brains. Any of y'all ever eat squirrel brains? Some of you. Well, that's one thing they got right, brother. That's a delicacy in Alabama. But listen, you can't do that. It's unclean. Now you're a dispensationalist, you don't even realize it. Let me ask you this question. I'll show you a dispensationalist. Do you believe in salvation by grace through faith?
Yes.
Well, you're a dispensationalist.
Yes,
because in the Old Testament, you can't get saved by grace through faith.
Right.
There's an element of grace and faith in everything, but if you don't bring the sacrifice and you don't live according to the law and you don't do what you're required to do, you go to hell like a bullet.
That's right.
How'd you like to live that way? You've got to have a pen of lambs out there, be able to have enough money to get a lamb before you can go into the temple to offer your sacrifices and so on and so forth. And on Sunday come along, you better not even crank up the furnace there or crank up the stove to cook anything. Well, I don't know about you, but I had a big breakfast this morning. My wife went down there. She didn't think nothing of it. Turned on the coffee pot, made my coffee, made my breakfast for me, brought it up there in my office, sat it down for me, and she said, you know, here, you're a dispensationalist, you can eat today. She didn't fix it yesterday. She fixed it today.
Right.
Seventh-day Adventists believe you can't fix it today. But they're not real Seventh-day Adventists because they drove to church. People down here on the street, down on San Jose Boulevard and stuff like that, they come up there, supposed to be their day of worship, right, on Saturday. They come up there, and they won't touch the button to cross the street. Of course, it'll get you killed if you're not, you know, but, no, really, pay somebody to push the button for me or give me a walkover. Well, how come you drove over to where you parked in the parking lot before you walked 3 blocks to church? You're not fooling God at all. God killed a man because he went out there and picked up some sticks on a Saturday. He killed a man for doing that. What are we going to do with him, Lord? I'm going to kill him. For what? Picking up sticks? Because he did what I said don't do. You're a dispensationalist. You don't believe that if he would kill you like that. Matter of fact, his mercy and his grace and long suffering sometimes causes us to keep doing things we know better than to do. What does it have to do with Revelation? Nothing, but it's good stuff for you to know. Help you to be practical in your life. Help you to appreciate the fact you don't have to live under the law anymore. You're under the law of Christ. That doesn't mean you're lawless. It means, hey, man, I don't have to worry about that stuff. My salvation's secure in Him. I believed on Him. Well, you ain't living it. Well, that's a whole other matter. And you're right, but I'm working on it. And yeah, I mess up, but I get up. Okay, good. That's what we're looking for. All right, Revelation chapter 22, we only got a few more minutes here, but you want to get a hold of that stuff. Don't get all hung up in thinking about this word. Well, what is a dispensationalist? It's somebody that's got enough sense to realize that certain things apply to you and certain things don't.
Right, that's right.
It's that simple. I'm not to be crude, but I'm going to say this. You walk out the back door here and you turn left if you're a male, and on the sign right there, there's a little woman there with a skirt on, and it says women. Now, is that for you?
No.
If you're a man?
No.
No. You go to the one that says men, right?
Right.
You say, well, what a dumb illustration. No, it's a perfect illustration.
Sure it is.
You go to what's for you.
Right.
Well, I need to go to the bathroom. Then go to the men's.
Right.
We have unisex around here.
Right.
Unisex. We all, Men, women. So when you come to the Bible, you say, is that for me? And the Lord says, yeah, that fits for you. That wrench fits right down on that nut just perfect, man. It won't strip the threads or nothing else. Crank it down. That's how you apply the Bible. Revelation chapter number 22. There it is. Let's start the last chapter of the book of Revelation. Verse 1, and he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. Now, it's proceeding. That means moving. Gushing forth. And that's actually underneath a throne. It's like there's a fountain underneath that throne that's there. And that thing's bubbling up underneath that throne. And it runs out through that thing and drops off the stairs of that throne up there. And then it runs out, and there's so much of it that it makes a pure river of life right down the center of that city. And I'll show you here in just a minute, every tree that's planted alongside that thing. You ever notice man's obsession with, they like to line their driveways with trees? You like those long tree-lined driveways and stuff like that? My wife likes to go through certain parts of places in the mountains up there, and there's trees that are, you know, like sentinels along the way, and you drive up through there. And of course, I don't know about you, but in my mind, I think it'd be great to have a driveway about, a mile long and have trees down through there, and you twist and turn until you get way back up in the woods somewhere or something like that. You ever notice how man's obsessed with that? You know where he gets it from? Right here. You want to see trees, what, on either side of the river here. That's what he's talking about, these trees that are there. This passage now that we're going to talk about, these first few verses, all the way down to about verse number 6 or so, they fit with the New Jerusalem coming down from God out of heaven. We'll step down to earth in just a little while after we get to talking about Daniel in verses 8, 9, 10, and 11. And then we'll start talking about the Advent in 11 and 12 and the tribulation of millennium in 13 and 14, the tribulation of 15 and 16, the church showing up in 17, and back to the tribulation in 18. So if you don't write and divide your Bible, you have a hard time in Revelation 22. All right, notice, in the midst of the street of it, where either side of the river, was there a tree of life, the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits and yielded her fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree were in the healing of the nations. Now, that reminds me to say this. When you study the olive tree, you find out about the olive tree that you can plant a tree here, and that olive tree's roots will run underneath the ground like that. Olive tree. Anyway, that tree will go down here, and its roots will come down, and all of a sudden a sprout will come out over here, and another tree will be here, and it'll run down there like a chain, but they're all connected to the same system. So when he says the tree of life is on both sides, what he's talking about there is every tree that's planted there is planted in such a way that it gets its source from its water from the river of life. So that thing runs all the way down like that. Now, you've got a running river. Why has it got to be running? Well, they tell you that a running river that runs at a certain amount of time, it cleanses or purifies itself every so many feet as it moves. So nothing stale, nothing stagnant up there in the New Jerusalem. And then the water that's there is pure and it's perfect, and so those roots go down and they tap into that water of life, and it's that water that gives them the proper nutrition to be able to bear the fruit that comes out and to have the leaves that are for healing of what? The nations. Well, they don't have sickness anymore, but the healing they got to have there is from death. The tree of life is so that people can partake of the tree of life, and by doing so, they inherit eternal life, not a glorified body. Adam would have had that, and Eve would have had that, had the Lord not put a cherub out there to guard that tree of life. Why did he put it there? Because in their fallen condition, if they'd have eaten it, they'd have lived forever in a sinful body, but they would have been living eternally. The first thing he did after she partook of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, knowledge of good and evil. Sometimes it's better to be simple concerning evil than it is to know everything. People say, well, I need to experience everything. I got to get out and try everything. I got to sow my oats. I got to do this. I got to do that. You know, helps you learn things. Simple concerning evil is the best way. You don't need to know everything to know something. Sometimes it's good just to be stupid. Really, with the increase of knowledge, the Bible says, cometh much sorrow. There's a lot of things you learn about in life that later in life, you know, you may boast or brag about them and think something about them when you're coming up, but after a while, you wish that junk wasn't in your head. You get older and you think, I wish I didn't know that. There's no benefit to knowing that at all. Just does nothing but just create garbage in my head or make me anxious or make me worry or something like that. Sometimes people go around, they say, well, you got your head stuck in the sand. I find out some people are pretty smart about that. They got their head stuck in the sand because they don't want to know. You say, why? Ignorance is bliss. Amen. Sometimes you get to knowing too much about what's going on with other people. You get to worrying too much. Right. Help me a little bit. Amen. You get bothered by it. Well, this tree here that we're talking about here, she partook of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, not the tree of life. And immediately the Lord sent a cherub down there and said, hey, guard that tree. A flaming sword, right? Round about. Well, that tree went to the heart of the earth, most likely was down in paradise, and then got raptured out and is going to be up there in the New Jerusalem. The Lord transplanted it. It was originally in the garden. He dug it up, got him a big tree spade, and went over there and backed up to the thing and, you know, cut the thing out of the ground and took it up there. You can't kill the tree of life. But now he planted it in a safe place. And anybody that wants to get it, they got to come into the city to get it. Well, you're already in the city and you don't have to have the tree, so it has to do with somebody else. But so that you understand, you can have a tree-lined river there on both sides, and it's all connected to one root system, but it's all connected to one water system. So all of you are like the tree of life in a sense. You're all connected to one root system. Amen. The root out of dry ground. You're all connected to one water system. The Bible teaches you in the book of John that when you get saved, that he says, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. When you talk to somebody about Jesus Christ, you're giving them the opportunity for eternal life. Amen. They nowadays, today, you don't partake of a piece of fruit. You take the message. You understand? They partake of the water. Not water like in a glass like they have for me back here. Not that water. What you're doing is you're giving them the water of life. What are you doing? You're preaching to them the gospel. Right. Preaching, not always yelling, raising your voice, all that kind of stuff. What you're doing is you're giving them a way out of hell. Amen. And so what happens is, he says, send Lazarus to dip his finger and cool my tongue, for I'm tormented in this flame. So what happens is they're begging for water because they don't want to go to hell. You give them the water of life. When they trust Jesus Christ, their thirst is quenched. Amen. So what do you mean, preacher? John chapter number 4. Hey, lady, how are you? Fine. You thirsty? Yeah? You want a drink of water? Well, you ain't even got a pitcher to pull it up with. You ain't got nothing. I'm the one with the stuff. I was going to give you a drink of water. No, lady, if you drink of the water I'll give to you, you'll never thirst again. Amen. The water that you give out is a water that may not quench physical thirst, but it'll quench spiritual thirst from then on. Amen. You say, what are you doing? You're putting the fires of hell out with the water of life. Amen. Well, in the New Jerusalem, after where everything's all passed away and all that, he's got that thing planted like a garden, like nothing you've ever possibly imagined in your life. And people come in to partake of that thing because it's all pointing back to, where did I tell you it came out of? The throne. That means whatever he touches becomes a pure source. So it's right out of his throne. That's why he does it that way. It's intentional. Where's the source of this river? Oh, it's the guy sitting up there. Well, who is that? Well, sit down for a while, honey. I'll tell you. Amen. I'll tell you what he did for me. Amen. They'll sit there in amazement. They'll just be utterly amazed and say, well, now let me ask you a question. Would you like to eat a piece of this fruit right here? It'll do something for you nothing else can do. Amen. What is that? Well, because of the source, if you partake of this fruit, you'll never die again. You know what you tell an individual when you lead him to Jesus Christ? Come on. You'll never die again. Amen. You'll never see death. None of you in here are ever going to see death. You say, preacher, people die every day. Not you. Your soul lives forever. You're not your body. Amen. You're what's on the inside. Amen. Your soul don't go to sleep. Your soul don't miss a beat. Amen. Your soul ain't even sleeping when you're sleeping. Amen. Your soul's wide awake. Yes. It's up there talking to the Lord, walking around, doing all kind of other kind of stuff like that. You're already seated with him in heavenly places. Amen. But your soul's wide awake when you're sound asleep. Your soul don't go, I'm tired. Your soul don't get tired. You say, what? It's got the Energizer Bunny inside. It's got the Lord inside. It don't ever get tired. It don't ever get wore out. Your soul's wide awake all the time. What happens when you die? Your soul says, Whew, about time I got rid of that thing, man. Hallelujah. Cut my suspenders and let me go. He steps right out of that body and somebody says, quick, get the paddles. And he goes, no, don't, please, don't. Bring him back to life. Breathe into his breath, the nostrils, the breath of life. No, leave me alone. I'm good. I'm out of here, man. See ya.
Amen.
We're so consumed with staying here. And the Lord's like, hey, man, you're better off when you get there. In spite of all the messes you made and all the trouble you've caused and all the things you hadn't done you should have done and all that, it beats the fire out of going to hell.
Amen.
And I'll tell you this, it beats living in the flesh.
Amen.
So, well, preacher, I got kids and I got grandkids and I got, you know, things to do and I got money to make and I got, you know, houses to build and junk to get done and all that kind of stuff. My foot, man.
Amen.
You step up there in heaven, it's like, man, I never realized how light I feel now that I got rid of that thing I was covered in. Well, I'm going to get married. Now I'm in real love now. You don't even know what love is.
Amen.
Love nowadays is so perverted, you don't even know what it is.
Amen.
That's talking about real love up there. People say, well, what will we ever do? And you know what? It's just like a Pharisee. Well, you know, what? Who am I going to be married to? Whose wife is she going to be in the resurrection? The Lord's like, you really think being married is what matters in heaven? You really think a man and a woman being joined together is what matters in heaven? I got something that trumps that every time. You say, oh, you just don't know how much I'm in love, preacher. You just don't know. You don't even know what love is.
Amen.
Your concept of love is perverted.
Yes, sir.
It's twisted. It's something human. You can get a taste of what real love is. The real love he's talking about up there is a love that doesn't expect anything in return.
Whew.
Unselfish love.
Amen.
Loves you just because. No reciprocation whatsoever. The kind of love you know is you love it, but it has barriers on it. You do love them, but you do expect something in return. Each of you gets something in return. Well, I love my kids. Yeah, you may love them, but you get the privileges out of them cozying up to you and telling you how wonderful and great you are and this and that and the other, and they get to milk your wallet until it's dry. You ain't fooling me. They want something out of you. You want to believe that it's they really love you. They using you like nobody's business. When they're done with you, they'll wad you up like a dish rag and throw you away and go find somebody else to use.
Amen.
Not my kids. Okay, well, whatever. Your kids are the exception to the rule. You know, you try not giving your kids nowadays their way and see how long they hang around with you. Nowadays, it's a horrible thing. You know, they say, what did you used to do? In my day, my dad blistered my hind end. I know that's what they say, passé nowadays. You don't do that anymore. That's, you know, give them time out. Well, in my day, if you sent me to time out, that would mean you go to the garage and clean up the garage. Time out was you cut the grass. Time out is you get the shovel and you dig me a trench from here to there. Why? Because I said dig the trench. Get the pick and get the hoe and get the shovel and dig that trench. And I want it this deep and I want it this wide and so on and so forth. Well, can you tell me why? I'm not telling you nothing, but if I tell you one more time, I'm going to show you why.
Amen.
Nowadays, well, I'll send you to your room. Wow, put me in jail, throw me in the briar patch. I got a computer in there, and I got an Xbox in there, and I got an iPad in there, and I got a... You really want to punish a kid nowadays? Prevent them from texting. They'll faint.
Amen.
They will call HRS on you. DOC will be at your house. Department of Family Service will be, or Department of Family Services will be at your house to say that it's child abuse because you took their phone away from them. Yeah, little kids nowadays, they're pitching a fit because you don't have their iPad hooked up to their stroller while they're walking so they can watch their cartoons, and they pitch a fit. Getting quiet now. You got little bitty kids on Faceplant nowadays. Little bitty kids have their own Facebook account. Well, okay, fine. That's what you want to do. Send me to timeout. We're going to suspend the kid from school. Really? And send him to the playground at the house? You're really hurting him. In my day, suspension, they had what's called in-school suspension. You went in and you sat with all the other bad kids. And you had one of the coaches that was in there, and he walked around with a paddle all the time. He was patting it. In-school suspension. But nowadays, it's like, well, these poor little... No, poor little my foot. But you see how things have changed for you nowadays? I don't know how we got on all that stuff. But All right, well, it's just about time. Well, let's go just a little bit further. The Bible says this, and there shall be no more curse. All right, now the curse that he's talking about there is the curse that goes all the way back to Genesis 3. Thorns and thistles shall the ground bring, and it has to do with a curse that has to do with Isaiah 66. All that stuff's taken away now. There's no more no curses at all. Any curse that God put on the earth, any curse that God put on a human being, all that's gone. No more curse. No more delineation. You get nervous there. The Bible says, and the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, and His servants shall serve Him. That'll be your tribulation saints in Revelation 14, and that'll also be some of us that'll be up there as far as His servants. And they shall see His face. Come quickly to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'll give you a thought on this, and I can't say this for absolute positive for sure, but it kind of looks this way, and that's about as good as I can do. 1 Corinthians chapter number, let's see, is it 15, I believe? Yeah, that's it, 15. All right, verse 25. 15:25, I'll give you this, and then we'll take a break. 15:25, for he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. Who's he talking about? Then cometh the end, verse 24. There it is. When he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and authority and all power. So that's Jesus Christ, and now he gives everything to God. You see that? Verse 25, for he must reign, millennium, till he hath put all enemies under his feet. So that'll be millennium, that'll be Gog and Magog, and then all of a sudden you'll have a great white throne judgment. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. So death is done away with. You don't have to worry about it anymore. For he, God, hath put all things under his feet, Jesus' feet. But when he, God, saith all things are put under him, Jesus, it is manifest that he, God, is accepted, which did put all things under him, Jesus. Just talking about the line of authority here. Don't let it confuse you. Now watch. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, God, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him, God, that put all things under him, Jesus, that God may be all in all. Now, here's the best that I can do with this. It looks like that at this particular point, by the time you get to the New Jerusalem, new heaven, new earth has been created after the millennium, Gog and Magog's over, great white throne judgment is over with, and you're fixing to start off into eternity with none of that other stuff existing, it looks like that the Trinity comes back together as one. Now, that's what it looks like. They'll be all in all. Right now, they're divided into threes, right? They're three parts. Now, don't let this bog you down. You know, you try to understand the Trinity, you lose your mind. You don't believe it, you lose your soul. But you try to understand the deity of Christ, it's just hard to grasp, but it's true. All right? He can be three places at one time, and all of them can be living. Jesus Christ is being baptized by John the Baptist. The Holy Spirit descends from heaven like a dove, and the Father says, "This is my Son, in whom I'm well pleased, hear ye him." Right? He can be three places at one time, and all three of them are living entities. You can't. Now, you're a tripart being. You're a body, a soul, and a spirit. But in order for your spirit and soul to be released, your spirit go, that's your breath, go back to God, and your soul go to heaven, your body has to be dead. So what happens is your body dies and you go up there, or your body has to be changed. Then you become embodied, and who you are is what He makes you to be. You'll be conformed to His image. Now, when the Bible says they shall see His face, I don't know. The Bible says no man has seen God at any time. But Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So what it looks like is that they all three may come together, and they're either embodied in the sense that they're all back into God, and then God is just everywhere from then on, or they're embodied in Jesus Christ. You say, which is it? I don't know. Well, let's get up there and see, and when we get up there, we'll understand it. I don't know which one it'll be. It could be that it's God, because God fills heaven and earth. He fills everything that there is, and so they all become one. Or it could be the embodiment of Jesus Christ Himself. I'm not sure. Now that I've got you good and confused with that one, we'll go ahead and take a short break. Father,